Hello and welcome to my YouTube channel on PLC programming using CODESYS. In this episode, I'm going to show you how to use radio buttons in the visualization. So by watching this video, you will learn how to insert a radio button, how to configure it, and how to associate it with proper variables in the PLC code. Thanks for watching this video. Please don't hesitate to click on the like button underneath the video and subscribe to the channel if you haven't done it yet. Let's get started. In order to demonstrate how to use the radio buttons, I have created a project and have placed several items in the visualization together with the radio button. I also have put these two sliders here. And if I choose any of the items here, including the circle, rectangle, polygon, and pie, I'm able to move that item in the screen. So to the right or to the left, and also up and down. I do this by choosing one of them. Now I'm going to do it for the rectangle. When I click on none, the value gets back to zero. And then let's do it for the pie as well, and for the polygon similarly. So you can see that using the radio button element here, I'm able to choose one of the items at a time and then work on it. If you follow this video, you will be able to replicate a similar project on your own. So please pay attention, and I'm going now to explain you different components of the visualization, mostly with a focus on the radio button here. So I'm going to log off. In terms of these elements, I have the pie, rectangle, polygon, and the circle. For each one, I'm using an integer variable to determine the x and y movement. So for circle, I'm referring to the ix underline circle and iy underline circle. For polygon, I'm referring to these two variables. For rectangle, I'm referring to these two variables. And for the pi, I'm referring to these two variables. And all those variables are declared here already. On the other hand, using the sliders that you see here, one is the vertical and the other one is the horizontal, I'm determining value for iy and ix integer variables. And those variables are here. Furthermore, I have another integer variable, which I have called as iShape. And that variable takes value from the radio buttons. Depending on which item is selected in the radio button, either the first one, second one, third, and so on and so forth, I will have the value for this variable as 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And you can see what I'm doing here. If first element is chosen, which is for the circle, the value for iShape will be equal to 0. Using this case structure, I'm assigning the value of ix, which comes from this slider, to the ix underline circle, and the value of iy, which comes from this slider, to the iy underline circle integer variable. And therefore, as a result, the circle that you see in the visualization will move. And I'm doing the similar thing for the others, for the rectangle, polygon, pie. And finally, when none is selected, I'm setting the value for ix and iy back to 0. So for the radio button, we have a couple of settings. The first one is the variable that you see here. I have associated it with that integer variable, iShape, that I'm using in the case structure as well. So that's the first thing to do. Depending on which element in the radio button is chosen, the value of iShape will be determined. Then the next important thing for the radio button is the radio button settings. And that's what you see here. We have several areas that I have created. If you place a new one, by default, there will be two areas. And those two areas, they have this radio button as the text that you can obviously change, as I have done for the one that I have used here. You can also see the value. This is 0, which is determining the value for the integer variable, which will be associated with the radio button. As for the first element, 0 is used. I have written circle here, and that's what you see here as shown. Then in the second area, I have the rectangle, in the third one, polygon, then pi, and then none. If you want to add or create a new area, you can click on create area, and a new area will be added at the bottom. So here I can, for example, write a square. Yeah, once I type it, it will appear here as the last element, or I can click on delete in order to remove that element. You can also work on the sizing of the text, which is shown here, and also on the distancing. The distance is determined here. You can see that it is written as line spacing in pixels, so you can determine whether it's 4 that I've used here, or as an example, let me set 10 here. You see that the distance between these two is increased. That's something that you can work on it. Another thing that you may need to have a look is here. So the number of columns by default is set to 1, but this can be changed to another value. Depending on the number of the elements that you have, you can have multiple columns. Now I have created the radio button with 3 columns. When we have more than one column, you can also use this, the order in which the radio buttons are placed. It could be from top to bottom, as you see here, or I can change it to left to right, and you see that the order in which the buttons are shown is now a little bit different. Those are the main properties that you need to use for the radio button in order to choose among a given set of items or variables in through the visualization. I hope this video helps you. Please don't forget to like the video, comment underneath the video, and share the video with your network. Thanks for watching, and see you later in another video. Bye for now.